success in the next decades. This is why our newly adopted gender action plan is so important for us and a firm priority for me. Third, the means of implementation. We need to be clear that although it is important to maximize the level of official development assistance, it is also necessary to ensure that the assistance is used for the right purposes, targeting the greatest needs, and is accompanied by the right enabling policies. The European Union and its member states continue to be the world's largest providers of official development assistance. We have affirmed the intention collectively to reach the United Nations 0.7% of official development assistance target as a percentage of gross national income within the time frame of 2030 agenda. We have made a specific commitment for the least developed countries ultimately to reach 0.2% within the same frame of the agenda. Fourth, universality. The universality of the Sustainable Development Goals is a key element which resonates with the universality of human rights and democratic values for which you are and the European Union is relentlessly fighting worldwide. While reviewing our policies, we will have to explore the linkage and interface between Sustainable Development Goals and human rights to build a human rights-based approach to sustainable development. The universality of the Sustainable Development Goals also implies that education and the active engagement of all citizens are key factors to reach a sustainable future for the world, including within the European Union. This is why I am pleased to launch today the call for proposals of our program for development education and awareness raising in Europe, worth 90 million euros. We had an extensive consultation with member states, civil society, and local authorities to develop it. I'm confident that we got the most balanced proposal. I'm also pleased that we could adapt our criteria to be able to also reach out to small and grassroots organizations. I'm convinced that this program will be a major surge toward, forward to sustain formal and informal development education, to support campaigning and advocacy, and to showcase to the European citizens what we are doing well with our international cooperation and development policies. And fifth, accountability. Accountability is, and rightly so, one of the principles identified in the 2030 Sustainable Development Agenda. Throughout the negotiations, the European Union was firm and consistent on the centrality of accountability to successful implementation. And we had a fair degree of success in getting including the language that we wanted. The 2030 agreement refers in several places to the importance of engaging all stakeholders in the implementation of the agenda. Not just national governments, but parliaments, local authorities, the private sector, civil society groups, ordinary citizens, and academia. Clearly, civil society will be strongly engaged in implementing and delivering on the agenda. And therefore, it must have a say in how that implementation is planned. Ladies and gentlemen, I am very pleased that so many of you could come here to Brussels to discuss about our future at such a strategic moment. We very much value your work on the ground, often in difficult contexts. That is why I would like to conclude by making two considerations that are important to me. First, human rights and development are inextricably linked. They have the same ultimate objective to improve human well-being and freedom based on the inherent dignity and equality of all people. Human rights and development policies and strategies are therefore mutually reinforcing and complementary. In 2014, the European Union committed to move towards a right-based approach for development, which integrates the fulfillment of rights as an essential condition and a key leverage to achieve development and eradicate poverty. Somehow, by gathering for the first time civil society organizations from the development and human rights constituencies, this forum is a good evidence for me of this right-based approach in development. Second, in 2012, the European Union adopted a policy shift in its approach to civil society. This can be summarized in supporting civil society not exclusively as a provider of aid, but also as an actor of governance. To do so, we are promoting a meaningful and structured participation of civil society organizations. We are promoting a conducive environment for civil society organizations. And we are supporting civil society organizations' capacity to perform such a role as independent actors. Let me now inform you of a recent development I have decided to invite at our European Development Days next June, the president of Concord, to represent the voice of civil society and deliver a keynote speech at the opening ceremony of the European Development Days. This will take place for the first time ever at a very opening ceremony that a civil society voice will be heard together with head of states and governments and other most eminent guests. The European Union is one of the leading donors for civil society organizations. It is the world's leading donor for human rights and the first donor to support local society organizations in partner countries. This all comes from our wish to be not only the biggest, the largest donor, but also to be the best donor possible. But this policy shift also implies that we assume that it should change to some extend our conceptions of donorship. This is why I'm delighted that with the new protectdefenders.eu mechanisms, the European Union has significantly reinforced its capacity to protect human rights defenders at risk, saving lives daily. This is also why I'm delighted that we could sign today 21 framework partnership agreements with major international and regional networks of civil society organizations to deliver on these priorities. This is a strong signal of our new approach. It is an important concretization of this policy shift. It is a symbol of the coming years of renewed partnership ahead of us. And this forum was, has been, and will be the proof that European Union's development policy, human rights policy, and civil society actions and impact shall go together. Thank you. Thank you very much for your attention.
Many thanks, Commissioner, for your speech. I will now turn to our panelists. Dear panelists, Commissioner Mimica just explained the journey the EU will take to revise its development policy in order to implement the Sustainable Development Goals and the role envisaged for civil society. So let's say that you have now the opportunity to do the briefing for the Commissioner for the next 3 years. What would you put in that briefing, regarding the place and the role for civil society in the coming decades and how to best support and work with organizations in the field. So I will have, as first speaker, Pierre Clavier Mbon Nimpa, the founder of the Association of the Protection of Human Rights from Burundi. Mr. Mbonimpa is a militant Burundais des droits de l'homme, fondateur de l'Association pour la protection des droits humains et des personnes détenues. La qualité de son engagement surpasse les souffrances et les menaces dont il a été et est encore aujourd'hui l'objet. Nous sommes honorés d'accueillir Pierre Clavier, récipiendaire 2007 du prix Martin Ennals pour les défenseurs des droits de l'homme que l'on considère comme un des prix Nobel des droits de l'homme. La parole est à vous, Monsieur Mbonimpa.
Merci beaucoup. Mais bon, je vais d'abord. Vous allez m'excuser à cause de ma voix. Ce n'est pas ma voix initiale, non. C'est l'incident du parcours d'un défenseur des droits de l'homme. Ma voix, je veux dire, ma voix a été éliminée. Pourquoi j'utilise le verbe éliminer? Un jour, j'étais dans une émission radiodiffusée avec un politicien. Alors, nous avons discuté. Qu'est-ce qu'il m'a dit? Il m'a dit qu'en politique, on ne tue pas, mais qu'on élimine les obstacles. Même si vous entendez ma voix, moi j'étais franchement un beau chanteur de messe. La deuxième fois, je chantais la deuxième fois. Mais maintenant, vous entendez comment je parle. Alors, je crois que le modérateur va m'excuser. Si je vous dépasse de quelques deux ou trois minutes, c'est parce que je ne peux pas aller plus vite. Merci de votre diligence. Mesdames, Messieurs, tout protocole observé. À cette occasion de clôture de cet événement très important organisé par l'Union européenne pendant des jours, c'est avec un honneur que je voudrais remercier tous ceux qui ont contribué pour que cet événement ait lieu, à l'occurrence l'Union européenne. Je ne pouvais pas passer dans toutes les salles pour écouter les différents exposés. Mais je ne doute pas que ça ait été constructif. Je voudrais alors orienter son mot sur les thématiques qui m'ont été demandées, notamment la capacité de la société civile pour faire face aux différentes violations des droits de l'homme qui sont commises sur nos continents, et spécialement dans mon pays, le Burundi, ainsi que les recommandations à faire à l'Union européenne pour l'aider qu'elle peut apporter aux bénéficiaires des droits humains. Par rapport à la capacité de la société civile, je vais me focaliser beaucoup sur le Burundi pour vous montrer combien la société civile joue un rôle très important dans la société. En effet, après la décision dont notre président a fait de son parti obligé en troisième mandat en violation de la Cour d'Arrochal et de la Constitution, les organisations de la société civile a appelé la population à manifester pacifiquement contre cette décision. L'appel a été répondu, mais après, il y a eu une forte répression dans le centre qui a été faite par les forces de défense et de sécurité. Au moment où je vous parle, le rapport de mon organisation indique plus de 700 personnes qui ont été tuées. Je crois que mon collègue lié armé vous a dit ça. Sans compter ceux qui ont été jetés dans les rivières et les autres qui ont été enterrés dans de fausses communes. Vous attendez bien que le nombre total peut dépasser plus de 1000 personnes. Alors nous, la société civile, nous demandons chaque fois à la communauté internationale de soutenir le pays, même à aux Nations Unies, d'étudier le problème burundais et de voir s'il n'y a pas eu de génocide. Parce qu'on va compter à combien de morts pour dire qu'il y a eu génocide. Voulez-vous que nous atteignions le nombre du Rwanda? Je ne pense pas, ce n'est pas notre souhait. Malgré cela, la société civile a continué à travailler pour documenter ces cas et porter la connaissance de la communauté internationale. Raison pour laquelle, d'ailleurs, certaines mesures de pression ont été prises à l'endroit du gouvernement de fait de Bujumbura. Bujumbura, c'est la capitale de notre pays, le Burundi. C'est notamment cette mesure qui concerne l'article 96 de l'accord de Cotonou que l'Union européenne vient de prendre. Ni les rapports produits par la société civile, je pense qu'il serait difficile pour l'Union européenne de prendre une telle mesure car il ne doit pas être arbitraire. Compte tenu du temps qui m'est imparti, je vous épargne des activités de développement dans deux différents domaines que les organisations de la société civile effectuent, notamment la sensibilisation de la population pour adopter des bons comportements conduisant à leur bien-être. Pour le deuxième point, sans être exhaustif, nous recommandons à l'Union européenne ce qui suit. 1. Rester toujours aux côtés des défenseurs pour les appuyer dans les projets. 2. Soutenir individuellement ou collectivement les défenseurs en situation de difficulté. 3. Faciliter ou prévoir dans la mesure du possible, compte tenu de l'importance des visas spécifiques pour les défenseurs, afin de faciliter le travail pour se déplacer en cas de besoin ou la fuite en cas de circonstances tendues. 4. Simplifier les procédures d'appel à proposition pour les projets dans des circonstances exceptionnelles comme le cas du Burundi aujourd'hui. Cinq, soutenir les défenseurs Elle me dit qu'ils ont déjà fait des initiatives, donc continuer à travailler depuis l'exil. 6. Continuer à contraindre le gouvernement de fait par les autres moyens d'oppression, notamment le retrait des militaires et policiers en mission de maintien de la paix, car on ne peut pas donner ce qu'on n'a pas. Nous avons nos militaires, nos policiers qui se trouvent en Somalie, au Centrafrique et ailleurs, disant qu'ils sont là pour amener la paix. Pourquoi pas ne pas commencer dans notre pays, parce que la charité bien ordonnée commence par soi-même. Nous hésitons beaucoup sur ce point et ça sera la solution de notre problème. 7. Exiger l'ouverture d'un dialogue franc entre toutes les parties au conflit. 8. Exiger l'ouverture sans condition des organisations de la société civile et des médias suspendus. 9. Exiger une enquête indépendante sur les violations commises depuis avril 2015, c'est-à-dire depuis le début de la déclaration du troisième mandat du président de fait actuel, Pierre Nkurunziza. Mesdames, Messieurs, je m'excuse car j'étais censé parler pour tout le monde, mais vous comprenez que, compte tenu de la situation qui prévaut au pays, dans mon propre pays, je ne pouvais pas passer, je ne pouvais pas ne pas inciter, mais une fois que la solution est retrouvée au Burundi, cela pourrait continuer, cela pourrait constituer un bon précédent pour les autres pays qui seraient dans la même situation que le Burundi, car, comme le dit bien l'adage, aux mêmes mots, les mêmes remèdes. Je dis cela car vous savez bien que la plupart des dirigeants africains veulent s'éterniser au pouvoir en violation des lois au détriment de la population. Là, il n'y a pas de doute, c'est un problème presque dans tous les pays africains. Et la fois passée, j'étais à Genève, j'étais sur le panel avec celui du Rwanda, avec celui de Djibouti, avec celui de Kampala. Tout le monde avait les mêmes problèmes que les problèmes des mandats. Pour terminer, je vous remercie pour l'attention que vous m'avez réservée. Vive le respect des droits de l'homme, vive la solidarité internationale et je demanderai à l'assistance des applaudissements beaucoup envers l'Union européenne qui a pu organiser cette rencontre et pour que la société civile, presque du monde entier, peut se reconnaître, se voir et échanger les différents problèmes. Je vous remercie.
Merci beaucoup pour votre témoignage très émotionnel, pour la force que vous avez eue de parler de cette façon et de nous donner exactement votre approche de la réalité de ce qui se passe sur le champ. Votre appel était très clair. On a des facilités et des soutiens qui peuvent vous aider. Donc, c'est évident qu'on va vous aider dans tout ce qu'on peut. Je passe maintenant la parole à Madame Tétette Laurent from Asia Pacific Research Network, SPD co-chair. Maria Teresa Laurent, Tétette, comme on l'appelle normalement, plus affectueusement, is a development activist engaged on so many topics that it is difficult to list them. Maybe I can highlight two of them. First, that she's the chairperson of the Asia-Pacific Research Network. She was involved in establishing many independent regional and national networks in Asia. And secondly, that she is the voice of the CSOs in the, she will be the voice of the civil society in the upcoming high-level meeting on development effectiveness in Nairobi. So the voice is yours. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Ms. Bento. Good afternoon, Commissioner, Minister, all protocols observed, friends and colleagues. It's very hard to follow such a very emotional sharing, but I hope that I will also not make you cry, but be equally powerful. We have all been talking about Agenda 2030 in this last couple of days, and I suppose it is rightly so, because Agenda 2030 tries to offer a glimmer of hope that ours can be a better world for everyone. Because we desperately need something to hold on to, something to look forward to for our children and for our children's children. Because the now that we have is far from ideal. You know, we are feeling the impacts of this multiple crisis, economic crisis, political crisis, social crisis, environmental crisis. And in all of these crises, people are getting killed or are under threat or attacks, criminalized for environmental issues, for standing in the way of development. These development projects are usually involving extractives, not done in the Global South, using ODA, using loans, using investments. These are hydropower projects, mining, and other activities that would have to do with extracting natural resources from the Global South and for whose benefit. According to a recent article that I've read, the top five countries where there are killings of environmental defenders, number one, Honduras, Brazil, Colombia, Philippines, where I come from, and Peru. And 40% of the victims are usually indigenous peoples, women, and children, with each week at least two people are killed in all of these countries that I've just mentioned. The civil society forum that we've had in the last 2 days is indeed very relevant in our context. And to that, I would like to thank the European Commission for taking this initiative and leadership to open up spaces for dialogue between and among civil society, as well as with the Commission and the Parliament. And the signing of the Framework Partnership Agreements just a couple of minutes ago is also a step in the right direction. It is indeed a recognition that civil society are key development actors. We are closest to where poverty, inequality, exclusion, and repression is most felt in the Global South. Leaving us out of the discussions means getting only half the story right and half the work done. Over 4 years ago, Commissioner, the European Union endorsed the Busan Partnership Agreement on Effective Development Cooperation. Paragraph 22 of this agreement committed the EU and other donors to implement fully our respective commitments to enable civil society organizations to exercise their roles as independent development actors with a particular focus on an enabling environment consistent with agreed international rights that maximizes the contributions of civil society to development. 4 years later, however, we see that civil society space continues to shrink and CSOs can hardly see this commitment implemented in at least 50 developing countries. For civil society participation in development processes to be meaningful, providers like the European Commission need to help ensure that CSOs can participate as development actors in our own right. This means CSOs shouldn't just be called upon for service delivery. Although we certainly don't wish to downplay the role that CSOs play in delivering services, you know, stepping in where governments are mostly deficient or ineffective, but it also means that CSOs should be free and able to voice their views as advocates. It means being able to sit at the table together with other decision makers instead of merely reacting to someone else's decisions. It means civil society organizations should be systematically involved in development processes at national, regional, and global levels. This is what CPDE calls the need for institutionalized policy space. We need a structured policy dialogue at each and every step of the development process where we can dialogue and negotiate sticky policy issues with the European Commission and other donors and try to come to a decision together. These are crucial elements towards democratic ownership, which is a key ingredient to the success of any development initiative. And I guess we all need to be reminded that with Agenda 2030, as ambitious as a transformative agenda, we all need to own it. Democratic ownership is needed for Agenda 2030 to succeed. CPDE's participation in the steering committee of the Global Partnership in Effective Development Cooperation is a good example of what we mean by institutionalized policy space. We sit there as full member of the steering committee on par with governments, multilateral banks, and the private sector. We still have a lot to do to ensure that the Effective Development Cooperation agenda translates into tangible results on the ground. And we're indeed following it up at country-level dialogue through inclusive multi-stakeholder dialogues, you know, in support of the second monitoring round. I'm happy that the Netherlands is here. You may ask the Netherlands, and they will confirm that civil society organizations have been particularly proactive and have come up, yes? and have come up with concrete suggestions to enhance policy dialogue, and we will continue to play our part. We would like to see a similar dynamic of inclusive decision-making promoted by the EC as well. Our experience, based on daily feedback we receive from colleagues in the South, is that few EU delegations are actually aware of the different fora, different spaces, or what is called for in the EC communications on engagement with civil society or on human rights and democracy. At best, EU delegations still work in silos. You know, they talk to civil society, but these are existing project partners. But what about those organizations especially doing critical work on the ground and not project partners? Can the EC commit to identify clearer mechanisms between this policy space and inclusive multi-stakeholder institutionalized country dialogue? We recommend conducting this kind of forum at country level to foster the implementation of EC development policies. It would be good to see that the EC establishes national multi-stakeholder platforms in EU development policies to be facilitated by EU delegations, or at least to explore synergies with other national multi-stakeholder platforms where the EC can find synergies. We call on the EC to walk the talk and defend an enabling environment for civil society, especially when civil society organizations are under threat in a given country. When civil society organizations are targeted by repressive governments, few donors actually step forward to confront the issue directly with the government itself. And I'm so happy, it's very encouraging to note that the Dutch and the FinFund have also stepped forward, not in the issue of Agua Zarca in Honduras in the wake of the murder of Berta Cáceres and another member of their organization. Economic and political interests tend to take priority at the expense of democratic ownership, transparency, and accountability. But together we can change this. We can find better ways to collaborate and ensure coherence between what we commit to each other and what we work for at country level. We support discussing possible options for when CSO environment comes under threat, you know, like establishing early warning systems with EU delegations and developing country governments whenever possible in close synergy with this forum. Now, regarding the second question about supporting grassroots organizations in the field, the EC has a crucial role to ensure that grassroots organizations get the right support at the right time. We therefore suggest a focus on implementing your development cooperation commitments at country level in support of the SDGs. And perhaps it's a little bit frustrating that we are now talking Agenda 2030, but what I heard a few minutes ago is that we are still discussing meeting the commitments of 0.7% of gross national income, a commitment which was done, you know, ages ago in the era of Monterrey. So perhaps that also needs to be revisited in light of the huge resource requirements for financing sustainable development. The EC should play a primary role in confronting repressive governments targeting CSOs on the ground. And we need to help establish inclusive multi-stakeholder platforms on EU development policies at country level. As much as possible, we recommend that the EU strives to systematically consult with a representative of a country-level CSO before, during, and after EC interventions. And please avoid referring only to specific CSO groups who may be favored by repressive governments, but really do not speak on behalf of the full constituency. We have a number of policy suggestions. We would also encourage the EC to assess your own engagement with civil society in developing countries against the four principles of development effectiveness, namely country ownership, results focus, transparency and accountability, and more importantly, along the lines of inclusive development. In terms of financial instruments available to grassroots, we hope that there would be a diversification of support so that local organizations can rely on a variety of tools to pursue their activities. As mentioned by Pierre earlier, we hope that there would be more flexible funding mechanisms, particularly in the face of rapidly changing contexts that put grassroots organizations at risk of shutting down unless funding comes through quickly. We need funding for grassroots organizations to be more predictable, particularly in the medium term. And we would hope that the financing instruments would support democratic governance through capacity building, social and inclusive dialogue. And yesterday we started our forum with a 1 minute of silence for Berta Cáceres. But now I would like us to raise our voices because we do need to shout out to the whole world that we are coming together in this space and we would uphold and promote human rights for everybody. Berta Cáceres, presente. Thank you very much.
Definitely a session full of emotions, and I promise to stand still until the end. I very much appreciate the acknowledgement for the partnership agreements that you, the framework partnership agreements that we just signed before this session, as being the platform for dialogue and exactly to consider the civil society organizations. Not to be only for the service delivery, but also part of the dialogue. That is exactly the purpose of this framework partnership agreement. So I'm very glad that the message has passed and it's working. Only also just a comment as regards your request on the delegations to be aware of the engagement with civil society organizations. We do have the roadmaps for civil society organizations in 97 countries already. And these roadmaps are supposed exactly for civil society organizations to make the mapping of the civil society organizations there to understand, according to the communication that we did for civil society in 2012, to address all issues, including the one that you put as a priority enabling environment. So we hope that this is making a difference also on the partner countries, and definitely our EU delegations are engaged at least these 97 and more six on the road to adopt the roadmaps. They will make that difference. Without further ado, I will pass now to our third speaker, Henri Tipagne, Director for People's Watch India, Amnesty International and Human Rights Awards 2016. Henri Tipagne is the founder and executive director of People's Watch, and he has been tirelessly and bravely standing up for human rights in India and will be awarded next month the Human Rights Award by Amnesty International. Running campaigns on discrimination and torture, documenting human rights violations, providing human rights training and education in schools, reaching out to 500,000 children in 18 Indian states. People's Watch is one of the most notable human rights organizations in India. We are honored to give you the floor. Please.
Honorable Minister, Commissioner, Moderator, my very revered Pierre, Tete, and all colleagues in this forum. Let me first of all thank the European Commission for giving us this opportunity of addressing this plenary on behalf of all of you. Whatever is being said here is being said in the interests of a larger community of peoples beyond our respective national boundaries. And these are particularly, to quote from the Commissioner, to see how these very big pledges, which sometimes are very complicated to understand, are brought as local actions and changes that he himself very clearly pointed out. We were asked to comment in this plenary on the participation of civil society organizations with the European Union and how best we could support them and work with grassroots organizations in the field. These were very two specific mandates for us in the plenary to participate in. At the outset, let us appreciate the European Union for some of the very important changes you've made, particularly the trust placed in NGOs with the consortium project which you called Protect Defenders EU. This is a very important move. We want to appreciate you for that. We want to appreciate you for all your guidelines, for what they are. We will come to the implementation in a little while. For these forums that are regularly convened, providing us an opportunity of transparency, of debate, of discourse, and something which people, particularly in regions which are far away from Brussels, never have an opportunity to reach out. We also would like to recognize these roadmaps, country roadmaps for CSO participation that is being undertaken. How they are implemented is a different question, but the fact that they are there and the insistence is there is itself a major change. Most important, and we say it with a lot of pride, we are happy that you are the largest funder in human rights and the largest funder in the field of human rights defenders. And for on behalf of many people whose names you will never know, whose faces you will never see, who will never come to Brussels, whose names perhaps will never appear in papers, they will have to be the beneficiaries of your largest grants for human rights defenders. And that is something that all of us need to applaud you for. Because there is no single organization which is able to do this globally. And that is something that you have done, and it deserves our deepest appreciation. Why I am here? I am no great international actor to be here. And if I am here, I think there's only one reason I'm here. It is because Amnesty International indicated that I would get an award next month in Berlin. I've not yet got it. But why Amnesty would like to give me an award? And Amnesty's award to me is not because of me as an individual, but Amnesty's award for me is to highlight a country which is dangerous, a country which is arrogant, and a country which is defiant, and a country which is shrinking space for democratic voices. And they thought that there could be somebody who is visible, who could represent civil society in that country. And therefore, I stand here not as an individual, but representing a number of people in India who are putting up their fight against the Indian state, which, as we all know, is a democracy, but a democracy in farce. And I like what Maya said yesterday. Is it the great Indian democracy, or is it only the big Indian democracy? I think it is the big Indian democracy that we have here. First, I think it is important for me to put on place and break this myth of India as a democracy. India is the only country in the globe where you have a former UN Special Rapporteur on Health and a former CEDAW committee member, both of whom are trustees of an organization whose organization's legitimacy is being challenged and their registration is being challenged. Where is EU? Where is EU in this? They are not ordinary people. They are a former UN Special Rapporteur and a former member of the CEDAW committee. Both of them are lawyers in the Supreme Court of India. One of them was the additional Solicitor General of India till the last government. And yet, this is exactly what they have to face. And why? Because of their stance on human rights and the type of cases that they are taking in the courts of law and the embarrassments that they are able to cause the Modi government, which enjoys visiting different cities in Europe and the US continuously. This is India. Why is it that in 1997, India opposed caste and racism being read together in the context of the UN Declaration on Racial Discrimination? In 1998 to 2000, when the UN Subcommission on Human Rights, the old body, undertook a study and presented its first report, India was on the floor like a mad person screaming that caste should not be discussed globally. In Durban, where 200 others were present in the year 2001 for the World Conference Against Racism, India was once again there up in arms to see that we made no progress on including caste as an agenda in the World Conference Against Racism. These are up to 2001. 3 days ago, just 3 days ago, the UN Special Rapporteur on Minorities, Rita, made her report on minorities and caste-based discrimination. And 15 years later, you find the same position by India that caste cannot be discussed in the United Nations. We come from a country where a large section of our population belongs to a community of people who are discriminated and who are considered to be untouchables. And this has been the United Nations response, and this has been the response in turn by India. Where has EU been in all this? Where have you been in all this? There is a lady, a young woman, Eo Shamila, who is undergoing 15 years, not one, not five, not 10, 15 years since the 4th of November 2000, undergoing a fast unto death to make sure that the Armed Forces Special Powers Act is withdrawn. No response from the National Human Rights Commission of India. No response from the government of India or the various governments that have ruled the country. Where are we as European Union in situation of this sort? A young journalist, Teesta Settlewad, from 2002 onwards has been fighting in Gujarat, the home state of our present Prime Minister Modi. Fighting to ensure that there is justice done to the thousands who were killed in the massacre that took place there. Pursuing it to the courts of law, trusting the criminal justice system of our country, succeeding in getting convictions in over a few hundred cases for a few hundred people, and ensuring that almost 500 people, witnesses in those cases, are getting armed police protection for the last 5 to 6 years. She is targeted today. And because she is targeted, and because she got funds from Ford Foundation was targeted. And because Indira Jaisingh is targeted. That is the plight of human rights defenders who matter in the country today. Where was European Union in terms of peace time? It's crucial. The state of Chhattisgarh is another state where lawlessness to the core is seen in Middle India, in Middle East India. And recently, you have a series of cases coming from Chhattisgarh. And we see that it's crushed, and women human rights defenders being lawyers, being professors, being writers and journalists are being attacked, and political activists. Chemicals are thrown on their face, and everything is silent across the globe in terms of those people. Honor killings continue in the country on the basis of caste discrimination, justified by different sections of society. You cannot undertake activities with the UPR. You cannot intervene in treaty body negotiations. You cannot make communications to the special procedures. You cannot challenge the National Human Rights Commission of India before the International Coordination Committee of National Human Rights Institutions with foreign funds and with EU funds. People will not believe me. I paid the price. I stand before you today as a testimony. My own organization's registration was cancelled not once, not twice, three times. Each occasion, 180 days. 540 days my bank accounts were closed. We were told that you people trust the international system. You people trust Brussels more than Delhi. We were patient once. We received the second notice. We were patient the second notice. We received the third notice. And before the third notice was over, we went to court and got an order from court. And today, we are functioning back again. I was telling people, this was almost resurrection for those who believe in resurrection. This was resurrection of an organization where almost 120 employees were sent home. 120 employees. All those big numbers that were mentioned were things of before 2012. Not now, because we had to close down. We had to close down our shelter. We had to close down all the initiatives we had started. Our rehabilitation center had to close down. Our entire human rights education programs had to close down. And this is the power of the Indian state in terms of handling civil society organizations. And this is the democracy that we talk about. And it is key. It is no longer night. When I went to the ministry, I was asked, what do you do in Geneva when it comes to India? And the only answer I could say is upholding the Constitution of India in Geneva and reading them along with the United Nations conventions that we see there. And it was very confusing for the secretary to understand what he was saying, because that secretary was somebody who was already political and he's already entered politics at the moment. You have the International Dalit Solidarity Network, and we have our convener here and other members here, which has applied for ECOSOC status for 8 years. 8 years. The application is a Guinness record. For 8 years it is pending. And every year you ensure that when the application comes up in New York, it is turned down. Not once, not four times, not six times, eight times. With 69 questions from one country in the globe, and that is India. Can we expect the European Union to intervene? Your interventions, therefore, have to be very, very sharp, because you are dealing with an arrogant state, a defiant state, a state which says nothing can be done to us. And don't forget, there are peoples behind, standing, waiting for your strong support. Now, coming to suggestions, therefore, I think the first suggestion that we make is that we do not want human rights values to be sermonized to us. We would like international obligations to be insisted upon at every stage of intervention. It is these international obligations that you stand by, that you strongly stand by, which we would request for you to also stand with states like India, which are defying every opportunity that is there. I know it is a tough job, but that is that tough job that we ask the EU to come forward to do. The formalities of meetings with CSOs should stop. There are convenient CSOs, and my colleagues mentioned it very well, and the project holder CSOs. Go beyond project holder CSOs and go to CSOs who are challenging. Go to CSOs who challenge the European Union as well, because those CSOs are those who will continue to speak the truth, whether they receive money from you or don't receive money from you. And that will make a cutting-edge change. The financing of NGOs, I think we have to be a little more creative. I don't think for a long time people like us will ever continue to be able to receive foreign funds in India. The fact that I speak today and the fact that there is somebody sitting in this hall is sufficient for me to go back and have my next round of fun with the government. But we are political animals and we will continue to fight this politics. And we fight it not for ourselves, we fight it for a larger generation of people, a larger constituency of people. And therefore, can you be creative and try to see opportunities of financing people who will never be able to receive with these registrations, but would be able to receive through the UN resident coordinator in each country? The UN resident coordinators are willing to receive money and to channel that money to very, very political groups if required. I think these are opportunities that should also be considered kindly by you. We would be extremely happy that whenever there is a visit of a state minister from any of the EU state countries, any other European commissioners coming to the country, you take it and call for the most dangerous CSOs in the country and have open meetings with them. Because that is where you are able to show solidarity. You will have to stand with them in public, not stand with them in private in Brussels, but stand with them in public in Delhi, stand with them in Madras, stand with them in Hyderabad, stand with them in Chhattisgarh. Move on to their places and show that you are with them. I am sure you have the caliber to do it. You need to keep time to do it, because that is where the Indian state will start listening and being afraid of a stand of that sort. Because as of now, they know that our only concern of the European Union is trade. And if that has to be broken, these political stands have necessarily to be taken. Please support human rights defenders across the globe in litigation and huge litigation costs. I think that is already there. There are avenues for that, but these are huge litigation costs also for organizations, not only for individuals, also for organizations. I think you have to communicate strongly, if you can't with the government, at least to national human rights institutions in respective countries. The National Human Rights Institution in India is a very, very, very difficult institution as well. We have very funny chairpersons for the last 3 terms. So I don't say that is going to be an interesting dialogue for you, but I think it has to be done, because that is the avenue that we have created and that is the animal that exists there in the country. The last is to try to see whether we can also have a number of invitations for human rights defenders who are doing cutting edge work to be invited to the European Parliament, to be invited to Brussels, to make presentations, to be invited to the COHOM if possible here, because that will make a change. It was when Priya Pillai was traveling to London that she was stopped in the airport in New Delhi. And I would be so happy if there can be an invitation from the European Union for somebody like Teesta to come, and she gets a court's permission, and she stopped in the Delhi airport, prevented from coming to Brussels, because that is where the country starts reflecting, and that is where the discourse starts commencing. And I think it is this cutting-edge communication with CSOs that we are all asking for. I think the days of very cozy, convenient discussions with us should be over in as much as we deal with countries like India. I think much more serious work has to be done, for which I know you have the caliber, for which I know you have the commitment, but I think the political commitment has to come, particularly in your delegations. Your delegations do not work with that political commitment. And I hope that discourses of this sort will make way for discourses which will engage in such political commitment, because we see that really missing in terms of politics. There are meetings that I am called for in the European delegation in India, but I think they are meetings to tick off a column perhaps that you are monitoring from here. Can they be much more political in nature so that it really conveys the political message of where and with whom the European Union stands? I want to thank you for this opportunity. I think the cartooning is much more interesting at the moment. And hope, and really hope, that this voice is carried out.
Just needs to catch his plane. So thank you very much once again, Minister, for your for you, for coming and for delivering. So, we have another emotional testimony, indeed, and, spicy and testimony, and emotional, full of emotions, this closing session, indeed. But it just shows how the subjects we are tackling here are of such an importance and very sensitive. And that, well, it even gives us even more a motivation to continue working with them and to make a difference on the spot. So this is just a live emotional testimonies of what is happening, and it's very good that these things pass and are shared with all of us. Anyway, we heard your recommendations, we heard everything, so thank you very much for all the recommendations that the civil society has given to us. We took good notes. And we come now to the closing of this session, because we are exactly just about the timing, so very well managed. Thanks a lot for all the speakers. I just, before we close, I just want to make two announcements. Well, first is to thank many people, and secondly, to make an announcement of the next session. The first on the thanks, I want to, first of all, thank the Commissioner for the support he has been giving us and for the idea of having this this forum. I think it is proved that it was an excellent idea. Thank you very much. And secondly, to thank all these people that were behind the preparation of this forum, that is it has been very intense. And in the case of my unit, it has been the whole week. We have been having the policy forum on development. The first 3 days, we had the development education awareness raising multi-stakeholder event for Tuesday and Wednesday. And then Thursday and Friday, we have this one. So it has been very intense for my team. I want really to thank them very well. And I would like them to stand up if they are in the room to give an applause to them. Colleagues, of course, of the unit B1 and of our director, Jean-Louis, and his team of the Human Rights, Democracy and Governance. Thanks a lot for all that. And now the magicians that have been behind all this, it has been many thanks to Mark, Philippe, Daphne, Barbara and Filippo, and translators, the services of the catering, the hostess and the guards, the help desks, many, many thanks. You did a fantastic job. Thank you for this. And so the announcement before the session is closed, but the announcement is that we have the session now on development, education and awareness raising program that also explains the call for proposal, which was launched today. So if you are interested in that, it will happen now. So please go. The people outside will indicate in which room. I'm told that is at the left when you go out. So thanks a lot. Thank you very much for these two very fantastic days. Thank you.